everyone. Thank you so much for joining into another episode of your favorite program, The Money Minutes. Today, we're going to be speaking with a CPA from M&P who focuses his practice on medical health professionals. His practice since 2010 has been focusing on guiding, counseling, and basically enhancing the tax experience for medical professionals. Today, I have invited him to talk about the five tips that he shares with the new residents, students that are going to be starting their practices soon. What are some of the things that they have to watch out for and basically implement before they start their own practice? So without any further ado, I'd like you to meet Steve Aikenhead. Welcome, Steve. I know you have a lot of great ideas to share with our viewers today. This is our first session, so I think it's best that we focus on medical students, residents that are going to become doctors soon. What are some of the things that they need to plan and think about upfront before getting into their own practice? You know, they've spent a lot of time studying, focused studying, maybe even borrowing to study. Mm-hmm. And now is their time to start and look forward to a practice and earnings. So as a CPA, Steve, and I know you focus mainly on medical professionals, so and professional corporations. So what are the top five tips for our viewers today?
Sure. Well, thank you very much, Seema, for inviting me. I'm happy to be here and help out your viewers with these tips. Hopefully I can provide some information and knowledge that they can take away with them. So I've developed five tips for residents. So resident physicians, I focused on that stage of their careers. And what, I mean, the overriding theme of this is all about transition. You know, physicians, you know, the only constant in their lives has been transition. You know, going from medical school to residency and then into practice, it's a whirlwind. And you know, we can help out as on the role of advisor with respect to tax or financial planning or anything else that we can assist them with. I think it's great for where they're at and where they're going to be shortly. So with that said, I'll start off on tip number one. And again, I'm sort of focusing on the resident phase and working forward through to practice for the average resident physician. So tip number one is tuition credits. That's going to be something that's common to all residents. Essentially, you've gone through your whole scholastic career accumulating all these credits. It's been very expensive, very arduous. The silver lining, if you can pick one from the financial side of that, is that you do get some tax relief from your taxes in the form of the credits when you can start utilizing them. So my first tip, there's really two points to it, is one, make sure your tax filings are up to date. The nice thing about being a student is that you haven't earned income, you haven't had taxes to pay, you haven't been required to file a tax return if you didn't want to. And sometimes what I see is when a resident comes to us for assistance, they haven't filed their last 3, 4, or 5 years of returns. So my advice would be get caught up now. The reason why it's important is you're not going to owe tax on that, but you're going to establish the tuition credits that you've accumulated to date, which is going to be very valuable to you. And you don't want to wait until the first year that you're going to have income to report, because if you do that and you do say 4 years of returns all at once, it's just going to delay that refund that you really deserve and need in your pocket. So, you know, if you can get caught up now before your taxes are due come spring, it's just going to be all that much better for you. And, you know, you'll get a refund within a couple of weeks. And it's just better to be up to date now. So get up to date, get your tuition credits established and ready to go. And the second part I would like to talk about is the utilization of the credits themselves. So up until now, if you're just starting residency, say this year or next year, you haven't used your credits. You've been building them up. They've been building in value. When you start to earn income is when you'll start actually utilizing them and getting that tax relief. And one thing I want to just sort of touch on is I do see that there are some residents who will choose to not have income tax deducted from their wages. Reason being is they've got their tuition credits in the background ready to be used. And the thought is, and it makes sense, the thought is why would I want to give up some tax dollars now to give to the government that I'm just going to get back on a refund come the spring? Well, why don't I just keep those tax dollars in my pocket? That makes sense, right? A dollar today is worth more than a dollar, you know, tomorrow. The problem I'm seeing, though, is there's a couple of issues that I'm noticing myself. One is you've got to time that. You've got to get the timing of that down almost perfectly to not have a shocking tax bill at some point in your residency. Because what happens is you've got these tuition credits. They look big. They sound big. You might have $100,000 of credits, six figures. It doesn't last as long as you think. Essentially, in your first year of residency, if it's a half year, you might have $30,000 to $35,000 of income. Year two, you might have somewhere around $70,000 to $75,000. Year three, maybe $80,000, somewhere in that range. Well, $100,000 of credits is going to be used up by the time they get to year three, right? In the middle of year three, your income will have surpassed the credits you have available. And if you don't catch that and you don't go to your payroll department and get that income tax starting to be withheld from your pay, you're going to have a very large tax bill. And I've had conversations with clients who didn't understand that, didn't expect that was coming. They owe $10,000, $15,000, $20,000 of tax in April. And there's panic, there's shock. They've got to go to the line of credit to pay it. I would recommend avoid that scenario. Have the tax withheld the way it, you know, is calculated to be withheld. Get your refunds every spring. Know that you're not going to have this huge liability waiting for you. And also, I don't like the idea of somebody living off of a gross wage as opposed to a net wage. Your lifestyle might all of a sudden become too entwined with, well, I've been living off this gross pay that I get paid every 2 weeks. Suddenly you got to live off of a net pay because their credits are all used up. Again, I think it's better to start living that lifestyle from day one and not have to have a change midway through.
I think it's a very good advice, and I've seen those panic attacks. I've seen people, new doctors call me and say, I don't know why I owe $40,000 to CRA, you know, and thank you for mentioning tuition credits. And a lot of us actually take that for granted. We feel, okay, because we have tuition credits, we're not going to owe any taxes. One question, Steve, from that is, what about the students that are coming from, let's say, United States? Do they also accumulate? So Canadian residents that go outside to finish their school and come back, do you have any tuition credits?
Yeah, so they do. The typical resident will be a Canadian student. So that's a pretty easy process. You go to school, you pay your tuition, your university will issue you a slip, a T2202. Download that from your portal. You give it to your accountant or you do it yourself. It's pretty straightforward. You can report foreign tuition for credit here. There's another form. It's called the TL11A, I believe that's what it's called. Essentially, you have to get your university administration to complete that. Fill the details regarding the course, the duration, the cost. It's got to be converted into Canadian currency. But yes, that will be applied as tuition here in Canada as you go forward. And typically, the foreign tuition is quite a bit more expensive than the Canadian tuition. That's you go to an American school versus a Canadian, you're looking at much higher levels of tuition costs. So back to my earlier point about getting your tax filings up to date, I think it's even more important if you're attending, if you've got foreign tuition and you're reporting as a Canadian resident. I don't want to go too far into the weeds on the residency concept, but if you're reporting your Canadian returns, incurring that foreign tuition, get those filed. If CRA wants to take a second look at some foreign tuition, get that handled and out of the way as you're incurring it, and don't let it build up so you've got 4 years of returns all at once that CRA is probably going to look at, and it's just going to delay things for you.
No, very good advice. Thank you for that.
No problem. So the second point that I have a tip for residents is just to sort of get an overview and understanding of what your tax return will look like now as a resident as compared to what it looked like when you were a student. It's still pretty simple. The simplest tax filing is a student tax return. You likely have little to no income. You're reporting the tuition. It's as easy as can be, and that's as simple as it gets. When you transition into residency, it's still pretty simple. You are now reporting employment income. You're going to get a T4 from your employer. The nice thing is that your employer has done all the heavy lifting for you on the accounting side. So they're tracking your gross wages. They're calculating your deductions. They're paying the government, you know, what you owe on your behalf. They're giving you a nice, clean summary in the form of a T4 to put on your return. And all you got to do is put that on your return. So it's a little bit more complicated, but it's still pretty simple. The one main difference to be aware of as a medical resident is that you do have another form of tax relief available to you in the form of a deduction known as employment expenses. Deductions provide tax relief at a greater rate and a greater effect than credits do. Essentially, you get relief at your marginal rate of tax as opposed to credit, which is at the lowest rate of tax. But with that said, the CRA does scrutinize heavily employment expenses that get reported. Employment expenses are heavily restricted, and those restrictions on that form of deduction don't really go away until you enter practice. When you enter practice, your ability to report a deduction expands quite a bit more. But as a resident, there are some employment expenses that are available to you. And again, these are valuable to you. You should make sure that you understand what you can and can't do and get that on your tax return and realize that recovery is as much as you can. So with that said.
And Steve, is it okay for our viewers to send direct emails to you if they have any questions?
Absolutely.
Get in touch with you.
Absolutely.
I know we can't really cover all the details on this message, but they can reach out to you or me and ask their questions, and we'll try our best to
get back. The only thing I want to make residents aware of is the fact that a lot of residents think that they can deduct anything that they've incurred cost-wise that they've incurred to enhance their career. And that makes sense, except there are restrictions. Essentially, you're limited to what your employer says you can deduct on a special form that you need your employer to sign off on. If you try to deduct anything outside of that form, it's going to get denied upon review. And there are a lot of costs that are out there that, you know, when I help a client with that type of filing, you know, they're surprised to know that they can't deduct certain things. They can't deduct OMA fees, right? OMA dues. You'd think, well, why couldn't I deduct that due or that fee? Well, the employer doesn't require to be a member of the OMA. So then CRA says you can't get it. So again, you know, if anyone has any questions, I'd be happy to go through in detail what you can and can't deduct there.
Perfect.
Point three is an overview of tax you can expect to see when you enter practice. So you've gone from two versions of tax filings that were pretty simple as a student, as an employee. When you enter practice, you're now self-employed. Your tax returns will become much more complicated. You no longer have someone doing the accounting for you. So you've got to track your own revenues. You got to track your own practice expenses. You have to determine your own tax payable, and you got to pay that tax. No one's going to pay it for you. So it's very important that in, you know, the first year of practice, you know that, okay, for every dollar I'm earning here, you know, I can't go spending that as if it's mine, because a chunk of that is actually the government's, right? So you got to understand that and know that going into it, that, okay, I need to set some money aside or at least earmark it to know this has got to go to the government in the form of tax, and work with somebody to help you on that end going forward. So that's sort of, you know, the complication begins there. You will get into the concept of tax installments. So after your second year of practice, when you've, you know, likely owed tax and paid some tax, the government's going to start asking you for quarterly installments. Again, you'll need to understand how that gets calculated, what are your obligations, and be prepared for that.
That's a huge topic in itself. When these doctors, first year especially, as soon as they finish the first year, CRA sends a letter saying now your installments are due, their first year taxes are due. They forgot to contribute to RRSP. If they have a good accountant right from the get-go, they make life so easy for them. But if they haven't, even this morning I was having a conversation where, you know, where do I come up with $60,000?
Yeah.
Right? If you're spending before you're earning.
Exactly. I was going to say the answer to that is, where do you come up with it? Well, you've already earned it. So you already had it in your pocket at one point in time, but you let it go, right? You spent it on something personally, and now you got to come up with it somewhere, right? So,
but you know, I'm a financial planner. I have to be a bit easy on them. You know, they've been working too hard. This is their time to enjoy. But yeah, absolutely. Take care of taxes. Take care of your deductions. Yeah. Take care of RSP before anything else.
Exactly. Yeah, for sure. And to that point, you know, when you, you know, get into that part of your career, tax planning becomes much more important. It always is important. It always should be at the forefront. It kind of isn't when you are a student or a resident because you've got so many other things going on and you don't owe tax. So you think, you know, I'll put that off. I don't recommend putting it off. You can't put it off when you're in practice because there's too many dollars out there that you have to be aware of. And you can get yourself in a hole pretty quickly without proper planning. So, you know, part of that planning when you enter practice, you know, you've likely heard about the concept of incorporation. You know, what does that mean to you as a practitioner? What does that mean to you as a taxpayer? Again, my recommendation would be to reach out and speak with a tax professional on incorporation. But more often than not, you're probably going to find yourself wanting to incorporate due to a tax deferral availability that you can get from that.
And how early do you think a student resident should come and talk to you?
To be honest, day one. So at MNP, we have a program that we put in place for specifically for medical students and residents. We provide complimentary tax services and tax filing for basic returns. And when I'm working with a client on their complimentary return, yeah, they're not going to get an invoice from me. It's free of charge, but you know, and it's not just that I'm filing a return and not speaking with them either. When we get to the end of that return and I speak to them about the results, we do talk about future planning. When are you planning on completing residency? What will be your first day of practice? What should you be on the lookout for, you know, all the way through so that, you know, if they say, you know what, I'm going to be completing residency in summer of 2024. Okay, let's get a meeting in place ready for that transition date, because the weird thing about this is when you enter practice, you're not just completing a residency and starting practice, you're becoming a business owner.
That's right.
And so it's really important that you plan for that as much as you can. And it's not a one-time thing. It's a continual process, right? Continuous learning. And you're always sort of, you know, working with, at least I am working with your clients on preparing for that moment.
So you're not just providing complimentary tax filing, you're also providing tax counseling. And
exactly. That's right. That's right. And I think it's important from day one. But, you know, there are a lot of clients we get that didn't have that ability to lean on someone for that. You know, they've started practice perhaps without having, you know, worked with an accountant. And that's fine too. All right. We will work with them and say, okay, what do we need to do now to get you as prepared as possible to minimize your tax, maximize your wealth, and move forward. So that it's really important that you always come back to the planning element. So another point I would probably also include in that transition planning for when you're in practice is also to consider your lifestyle. What are your cash needs to meet your lifestyle? Make sure you're budgeting, not just for tax, but also cash flow for how you want to live. And again, what I always say to a client who's entering practice is I'll say, hey, the lifestyle you were living in your last year of residency, can you do that for two more years? Yes, you're going to be earning a lot more income, right, than what you were earning. But if you can do that for two more years, wow, you're going to be so far ahead of the game. Then you can start, you know, changing your lifestyle based on your cash flow situation. But you're going to be ahead of the game. You're going to have a wealth of reserve set in place, it's going to benefit you.
So you ask them to put, you know, on hold that purchase of the new diamond ring?
If they can. If they can, that would be my recommendation. Now, I'm not the financial planner, but I just know what I see from the tax side. And it's a much better position to be planning for tax when you've got a wealth of reserves sitting there.
This is probably the best piece of advice that I have heard from any accountant so far, is that consider your lifestyle and continue to live as a resident for another 2 years.
Yeah, if you can. I know it's got to be hard, right? They've given up so much of their life and their time. They haven't really been making money. They deserve it, right? They've earned it. So it's a tough ask, but if you can do it, I think you're doing yourself a world of favor. And your future self will definitely thank you. So,
absolutely.
And then the last point I have is really to talk, we've already sort of talked about it to a certain amount degree here, but build out your team of professional advisors and do it from day one. Don't worry about the fact that, well, I'm only in residency and I'm not earning big income. I've got $250,000 of student debt out there. Don't let that intimidate you as far as getting your team in place now. You know, you're a financial planner. I know that if somebody came to you and said, hey, Seema, you know, I don't have positive net worth. I've got this mountain of debt behind me. Well, that's fine, right? That's where you're at now. And you're there because you're planning on having that picture turn around in the very short term. And it will, right? It's not that far away before you start earning income as a resident. And it's not going to be that far away before you start paying off that debt and accumulating wealth. Again, start from day one, get yourself a financial planner, get yourself an accountant that you trust. You're going to be needing to work with a lawyer, definitely when you incorporate. But even before then, if you are planning for practice and you've got a bunch of professional agreements that you need to enter into, you know, have a lawyer look at them. I'm not a trained lawyer. So when I look at agreements, I look at it from a tax angle, but I can't give legal advice. I never would. So, you know, get a lawyer, get a financial planner, get an accountant, build that team out now. And again, it will pay you dividends in the future. Don't let where you think you are now affect that notion. Go ahead and do it now. Again, it's going to pay dividends for you. And that's really it for the tips I have for the average resident currently.
Those were very valuable tips, Steve. Thank you so much for sharing your experience, your expertise with us today. And I know that viewers of this program will enjoy these tips and reach out to us for more questions. Your last tip, you know, build out a team. I always say that to my clients because I work in a team as well. I can't do everything for my clients. I have a team of bankers, lenders, accountants, lawyers that I can refer my clients to, and they can get right into, you know, that kickstart. I have a good team who's looking out for my benefit, for my rights. And I would love to have you on our program again, Steve. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I'd love to come back. Thank you.